Hi everyone. So my name is Ayelet Nesimi. As you can see, I'm a madricha in Mahoz Manchi, and I teach in an elementary school, Mevaseret Zion. Actually, my school is in Bidud now because we have a teacher who just, we found out she has corona. So I've had plenty of time to practice at home. all right, so as a madricha, 10th
grade,
12th
grade,
prepare your what's
that, pardon? 4 and 5 points.
Okay. So as a madricha, I've noticed that many of my teachers, the minute I bring in the topic of games, they instantly, automatically are opposed to the idea. Not because they don't enjoy games themselves, not because they don't understand why they're important, but because, well, hold on. Many teachers say that games take up too much time. They have the material that they have to finish. They can't possibly put it into the lesson. You know, I have to teach, I have to get things done, no time for that. But as we all know, games make all the difference. It can make a difference between a boring and dreary lesson and a fun and exciting lesson. They're one of the best ways to practice. They keep your students motivated. And the more motivated we want them to be, the more we should be giving them games. Not to mention that they're a great tool for informal assessment, so why not? Okay, and this is the second argument I usually hear. It's too much work. Yes, I guess it can be, but it really depends on which games you're bringing to the class. It doesn't have to be a lot of work. It can mean, I don't know, a bit of pre-planning during the summer, and that's it. You have a game for the whole year that you can just take out at the drop of a hat. So let's get started. I've brought you and I bring to my teachers the same ideas. These are a bunch of games that we do with very, very little preparation. So this is the first game. And I usually use it to review letter combinations. So Kita, Gimel, and Dalet usually. I like to start it in Gimel for the word Da, but obviously I would use it quite a bit in Kita, Dalet, and even later on, even till Kita, Vav, when I teach T-I-O-N or any other combination you might teach. So the idea is you call students to the board, you give each student a flashcard for a different sound. The teacher says the different sounds to the students. Whoever doesn't lift up their card in time has to sit down, and the last one standing is the winner. Now, normally I would like to get you all involved and make you play and be my students, but we can't do that right now. So I brought you a video and I'll play it now.
All right, let's do a review. Ooh, ow. Also, Eddie has to pick up again, ow. Good, shh, e. Ch, the, excellent girls. Ready, set, go. E, oo, ow. No, I'm sorry, Avia, please sit down. Good girl. Ready, set, go. Ch, e, ow. No, I'm sorry, Eden, please put it down.
It's
good. Okay, ready, set, go. The, e, ow, ch, ow. E, the, e, ch, e, ow, the, ow. Sorry, too late. Put it down. Good, please sit down. Ready, set, go. Ch, e, ow, e, the, e, ch, ow, e, ow, ch, ow. No, please sit down. Good girl. Ready, set, go. E, ow. No, too late. Please put it down. Ready. Yeah, good job, girls. Ready, set, go. E, ch, ch, e, ch, e. I'm going to try to babble with them, okay? Ready, set, go. Ch, the, ow, e, I. Nope, please put it down. We have a winner. Good job, Shabba.
So as you saw, I had two girls for the sound ow. I had the OW and OU because they both make the sound ow. And there's no reason to worry about that. Teachers usually tell me, Sorry, people are beeping outside. Teachers usually tell me what happens when you have two of the same sound. That's fine. It confuses them. Because their friend lifts up, they often lift up at the wrong time, and you can still play. It doesn't really make any difference. So that's our first game. And I should mention that before I even start with games, right at the beginning of the year, I like to discuss what being a good sport is, because it can start fights when you have games, especially in elementary school. Why did they get to win and not me? So just going through the idea of what being a good sport is and losing with grace and all of that, it's good to discuss it beforehand. Okay. Another game I like to play is called Kaboom. As you see, I credit Pinterest here. I couldn't remember exactly where I got it. The game goes like this. You write all of the vocabulary on popsicle sticks or tongue depressors so that you have more space. You can see them down here. So here we have an example of won't, cool, and one that says kaboom. Okay, so for every 10 vocabulary words, add a stick that says kaboom, as I did here at the bottom. Students take turns pulling out a stick, reading and translating the words. When someone pulls out a kaboom stick, everyone else has to return their sticks to the cup. So for example, the first student pulls out a stick and they take out won't, as I have here. So they say won't lo batid. If they got it right, they get to keep it. If they got it wrong, they have to put it back in the cup. The bonus here is not just the translation, it's also reading the words correctly, especially for the lower grades. If they didn't read the word correctly, I also make them put it back in. And obviously, once a student takes a kaboom, everyone else has to put all their sticks back, but they get to keep them. So there's a lot of shouting when we play this game. I usually like to use this game in Peltemi, or when I divide the class up into different stations, because this is not a game you can play with a full class of 30-something students. It's, I'd say, comfortable for up to 7 students at a time. Okay, let's keep going. Another game is fly swatting. And here I have credited Regina from a school I used to teach at. She's an amazing teacher. The idea is that you write vocabulary or sounds on the board and students use a fly swatter to hit the sound or word they hear. Winners can play only 2 rounds, so that way we can get through the whole class. So fly swatters are not something that I actually have. I have Nuff Nuff from a mangal. They cost, I don't know, 5 shekels. I have a stash in my English cupboard. And if I haven't prepared a game, because sometimes there is no time to prepare our lessons, I just keep those with me and I pull them out when I feel like it's time for a game. So let me just show you what it is here.
Ready, set, go. A.
Yes.
Good. Good job. Talia, give it to me.
Okay.
Give it to me. Please come, Leah.
Wait.
Ready, set,
go.
Go. Shh.
Okay.
Good.
So they just hit it. As you saw, one girl got it wrong, so she sat down. Someone else came instead of her. This girl who won would have sat down now because she already won 2 times. And it's important for me to get through everyone in the class. A great bonus to this game is that they stand up. Just getting the students to stand up and move around and cool off is a definite bonus. Great. Okay.
Ready,
Another game
set.
Is stacks. You write your vocabulary. Yeah, I know. I'm running out of time. I'll make it quick. I won't show the rest of the videos. You write your vocabulary on small cups, and whoever has the highest stack of cups at the end wins. Same idea as the game before. Vocab Jenga is another one I like to do in small groups or in stations. You take a game of Jenga, and the students, you write out all the words on the blocks, and you just play a normal game. If you make the tower fall, then you lose. And vocab B, I know we're really, really out of time, so I'll just show this one video and I guess I'll stop there.
סייקל למחזר. סלרי סולה.
וואן טו דה מקס.
שזה?
בעתיד.
גוד. מה בעתיד?
Okay, similar idea. I want the bee to get to the flower. If they can't translate the word correctly, it might be false. She didn't say that it meant no in the future. She just said that it meant the future, so she got it wrong.
Thank you, Ayelet.
I have many more games on the computer, and you can see everything when it's up on the site. Feel free to look through the games. Okay.
Thank you very much, Ayelet. Thank you so much. Our next presenter, Tanya, are you sharing your screen?
I'm about to, yeah.
Wonderful. Our next presenter, thank you so much, is Tanya Ben Chitrit, my colleague from Herzog College. And she's discussing enhancing the EFL classroom in the Haredi sector. And she is going to start directly.
Okay, thank you, Laura. Before I start, I'd like to just see a raise of hands. If you can all sort of go into the participants and raise your hand, how many of you are familiar with what distance learning means in the Haredi sector? Okay. Okay, so out of 79 people, so far I have 9 raised hands. So that means not many of you. We've heard a lot about distance learning in this conference so far. Lots of nice ideas for enhancing our distance learning on Zoom and the other digital platforms. But one thing that we haven't really heard about is what happens when we don't have that option. What happens when there is no digital platform? And that's what happens in the Haredi sector. And I'd also like to suggest that it's not just the Haredi sector we should be thinking about here, because one thing that's often overlooked is children who come from low socioeconomic backgrounds who also do not have access to computers and certainly don't have any way to learn if the school is doing distance learning via computer. So what does distance learning mean in the Haredi sector? So I'm referring to mainstream Haredi. There are many different streams within the Haredi society, but this is the mainstream Haredi schools. These are the options that we have, essentially. Option number one, and these are not in any order really, is to give a conference call. That is, you go on the particular line the school has been assigned. Schools have certain phone numbers. The students phone in, the teacher phones in, and you give a lesson on the telephone. And I mean telephone, this, you can see it over here, right? This thing over here, remember these? No smartphones, no screens, no, just a telephone, regular telephone. We have no way of seeing the student. We speak to them, they hear us, that's it. Option number two, also using the telephone, is to record a lesson on the line. That option has less interaction involved because we don't know who's on the other side of the line, or we can check the statistics who listen to the lesson, but they're not there. We're just recording the lesson, similar to the videos that Professor Orlando Barak was talking about just now. only there's no video, it's all audio. One thing that students should have, that is in the school system, is access to their course books. When the pandemic broke out, the schools all made sure that the students got their course books, and that allowed them to continue working together with the guidance of the teacher on the telephone in their course books. But in addition to that, most teachers, or at least some teachers, prepared pamphlets, booklets, worksheets, and so on and so forth, so that the students could keep on working within those booklets as they were listening again to the recordings or into the conference calls. Another additional thing that we have on the telephone is the option for the students to record themselves. And this is nice if we're talking about English lessons, It can be used in two ways. It's been used mainly for students to give their teachers some sort of feedback, meaning I enjoyed the lesson or I was listening, and often they get some sort of bonus for that. But one thing that I think it should be and can be used for is for the students to record themselves speaking. If you think about the Let's Talk program, for example, all the speaking programs we have, just having the students record themselves on the telephone, the teacher can listen in and then give them feedback on those recordings. So this is the platform, and these are the challenges. Challenge number one, obviously, is engagement. How do you engage your students when there is very, very little interaction? You can't see them, there's no visual. You don't know if they're even really listening most of the time. And in addition to that, we have the question of participation. And this goes two ways. Either students just don't participate, sort of like the black boxes on Zoom that we try to counteract in various ways. Or when you have a conference call, for example, you can have everybody speaking at the same time. That leads me to the next issue, and that's technical issues. Another thing that happens with conference calls is, I don't know if any of you are aware of what happens when you're in a conference call, and even though you as a teacher actually have the option of muting all your students, just like you do on Zoom, they can unmute themselves. And the interesting thing is when one student takes another call, puts themselves on hold, and you have this background music that you try to teach over. And even though you tell your students, you remind your students, don't take another call, don't answer the call waiting, it definitely interferes. So what I want to tell you about is what I think are the ingredients for success within this very limited platform. I don't think it's not necessarily something that I would like to adopt all the time, but if we have to adopt it, we have to think about how to do it in the best way possible. So here is, I'm going to present to you a unit of study that I gave to Yud Gimel and Yud Dalet students in Ofakim Seminary, May 2020. And what I managed to integrate into this lesson, which I think made it successful, or these lessons, it was a series of lessons, were multiple language skills, lots of different methods, using all the different methods available to myself, well-organized materials, clear instructions, explanations, and not to leave them any free time. And I'm going to explain each of those in more detail now. So what do I mean by multiple language skills? I had them listening, reading, and speaking. I actually had them writing later on, but not within this unit, so that's why I haven't got it here. Integration of methods. Well, I recorded lessons, they used their pamphlets, and I also carried out conference calls. The materials were well organized in that the pamphlets were clearly dated. They knew exactly when they should be doing what and where they should be when. Everything that was recorded was also transcribed. So I gave them a transcription of all the recorded lessons, and they could actually read it. And I find that often helps EFL students if they have the words in front of them as they listen along. And another thing was a detailed schedule. They knew to the minute where they should be and when. Instructions were clear, recorded on the telephone and in writing, and I didn't leave them any free time. And I want to show you exactly what I mean by all of that. I'm going to share the booklet that I prepared for them with you. Okay, can you see it? No? Yes? Okay, great. Okay, so this is, I basically revised the syllabus because obviously we disappeared for a while, came back on the telephone, and everything had to be, or the booklet had to be prepared, as with everyone. We all had very, very little time, and obviously the challenge here is there's no way to get it to the students, there's no email. So the booklet was prepared and sent to the secretary, who then sent it by post to the students. And the idea was for them to get it before our first conference call. before that, they had a recorded lesson. And in the recorded lesson, I actually finished up a previous topic and then introduced to them the topic of growth mindset, which is the topic that of this unit. I defined the terms for them, fixed and growth mindset, on the telephone, and then I wanted them to be able to define it in their own words in our conference call. Okay, so we move on to the next week, where we are continuing with the topic of growth mindset. Here they had a recorded lesson where they would listen to Carol Dweck's speech on growth mindset, recorded onto the telephone. And together with that, as you'll see in a second, they had the transcript. So the idea was that before they listen, they were supposed to look over the transcript, highlight any difficult words that they found in the transcript, and see if they understood them after listening. If not, they were supposed to come ready with the words the following week to, so that I could explain them to them. And then the following week, I was going to interview each one of them. Yes. Whilst they were, sorry?
I'm giving you a 1 minute notice.
Okay, thank you. I was going to interview each one of them. They were going to tell me all about what they've learned so far about fixed and growth mindsets. And as they were doing that, they were going to work. And this is where the no free time comes in. And let me scroll down to show you the materials so you can see exactly what I'm talking about. So here is a transcript of Carol Dweck's talk. This they were supposed to read along, highlight, then listen. The next week, here's some expressions that they could use together with vocabulary that they've taken from the talk to speak about the growth mindset. Then I give them a very detailed schedule of what time they're going to be interviewed on the conference call. You notice that I give them each 3 minutes to talk to me individually, but we start at 9, so I have 10 minutes to explain very clearly to make sure they've all understood what it is they have to do. While I'm talking to the students, each of them then has a page of an article to read. They have to scroll down and find their name, and then they have their page to read, and together with guided questions at the top of the page, they're supposed to read the page, use the guided questions to help them summarize it. So they're busy while I'm talking to the other students, and then we all meet together for at the end for the conference call. Okay, just can I just summarize?
Okay. Go ahead.
Just a second, I want to share the last slide. So just to reflect, and I'm still reflecting, I'm still teaching within the Haredi sector and learning all the time. And I think that's what we're all doing within, you know, in these times. And we all have to reflect and grow, learn from our mistakes. And I think that's what I did. I think the first conference call, learning about the fact that students can make a lot of noise on the line, led me to make sure that everything was very, very organized. I think we all need to share our successes at these times, share our stories so everyone can learn what it is we can be doing, communicate the concerns that we have for the future. And I think there are a lot of them when it comes to distance learning on the telephone, but ultimately let's enjoy and strive for more. Thank you.
Wow, thank you, Tanya. That was so interesting. I think so many of us complained about the challenges of this period, and that's with the Zoom and the computers and the internet and the smartphones. This is really eye-opening. Thank you so much. And now I'm turning the floor to Nassrin Rabi, who's going to talk about integrating digital media into the online and offline lesson. And here's the floor, Nassrin.
Okay, thank you. I'm sorry if you hear some sound in the background. It's just calling for prayer from my town village. I hope it doesn't interfere that much with you all. Okay, so I'm going to try and go through everything very quick because it's very challenging to finish everything within 10 minutes. I'm sure you would all agree, but let's see how far we get, okay? So the first activity I'm going to talk about is jot it down. And every activity I present here could basically be done through an online lesson. That means from distance learning, a distance learning lesson, or a framework of an actual classroom as well. So it could work both ways. And let's see what it is. Okay, so jot it down means to write something very quickly. The procedure is that you need to explain to your learners and your students what the meaning of jot it down means. And I would start the lesson with a small activity that is about 1 to 2 minutes. And I would say, jot down 9 words that start with F. Okay? And it could be with anything else, of course. The idea is to get them recycle and revisit words that they have already learned and get them to write them down. And I would add a little bit of a shake it up a little bit with using online stopwatch. If some of you are not familiar with this site, it's very, very nice to integrate a timer in your lesson. This is the website. And if you scroll down, you would see here classroom timers. And there are many ways of how you can integrate a timer into your online lesson or in the lesson that you're actually teaching in class. I usually go with bomb countdown. I really love the echo of the sound at the end with the boom at the end. And it could be done also, you could also add a follow-up where you could ask who wrote at least 6, 7, 8, or 9 words. And don't forget to applaud your students' efforts because encouragement is very important. And then for whole classroom feedback, this is the part I love the most, where you could elicit the words that they have written and write them on the board or on in this case, on the shared digital screen you have with your learners. And students can self-check themselves at this point and they are not put in, you know, on the spot of being, you know, checked by the teacher or anyone else. If your students are more advanced, you could also ask them to work in you could also ask them to use Padlet and share their answers through a digital platform as well. And ways of how I use it with, for example, helping them, for example, recall, remember consonant words or silent letters or other ways as well. It could be I could ask them to jot down words that end with, for example, consonant letter or other things as well. As you could see here, you could also use it with write down at least 10 verbs, adjectives or anything else. So this is a nice way to recycle learned vocabulary. Another activity I do with my learners is called blurry image. And blurry image means that you show them something that is unclear, something is vague about that image. And I get them to, in the process of asking yes, no questions or WH questions, to guess what the word is. And this is a point of the class where a lot of engagement is going on. And you could divide them into groups or into pairs, and they could keep on asking questions, but they could only guess, as you could see here, they could only guess 1 or 2 or 3, you set the amount of times they could guess what the blurry image is, but they can keep on asking questions as much as they want. And the idea is to get them to ask a lot of yes, no, and WH questions. And when you answer, you only answer as a teacher with yes or no. You don't add any more information because you want them to be eager and come up with more. And they would start asking you, what is the meaning of this? You say, I don't know. You have to go back and check and work with a partner or work with your group. So this is an example of an image. And I would like to note here that it's very important if you're teaching a unit about transportations, or you're teaching a unit about animals, or you're teaching a unit about, I don't know, climate change, anything like that, you would select an image relevant to the theme that you're teaching, because the things are fresh in their heads and it will be easier for them to interact with you. So this is an image of, for example, I don't know. At this point, I would have given you time to actually interact with me and ask yes, no questions. But because we're limited, I'm going to show you what the image is. It's a camel. So how is it done? I'm going to share with you how it's done. If you would like to do something like this in your classroom, what you basically do is, I'm going to share it with you. You on your PowerPoint presentation, you add and insert a picture. And then when you double click, as you can see it, when you double click, a toolbar here opens up and you go to artistic effects. And you have various options of changing, you know, the effects of the image. And I usually try to choose this one. Sorry, not this one. This is the one I like to choose. And I could also add artistic effects as well. And I could play with it to make it more blurry, more unclear, and so on. And this is basically how you do it. So it's really nice to give it a try and give it a go with your learners. And let me get back to our presentation, just a sec. Okay. And then this is how we do it. And then the next activity is called dialogues. And I'm sorry for really running quick, but I just want to squeeze in everything for you guys. Okay, so dialogues, and we all know that at the end of the day, I'm sure this is a mutual understanding for all of us as language learners. We want our students to go out into the field and actually produce the English language and you know, be able to communicate. That's the whole goal at the end of the day. So what I did is, this is credited for the British Council website, where they have a section for speaking activities, and they share small videos for real life situations and dialogues. And in this case, I would bring in an image, and I like to start with a model, showing my students some model, because I think that learners need to see an example in front of them. It makes them feel more confident. They understand what they're supposed to do. And at this point, I would also give a hint that they need to use intonation with their voice. I wouldn't say intonation, but I would say something like this. How would I read this? I'd like a nice steak for dinner tonight. Or would I read it as, I'd like a nice steak for dinner tonight. And they would get to understand what intonation means here and really act it out. It would be much more fun. And then I would say, thank you, we'll take it. Or thank you, we'll take it. It would be so much more fun. And it would be, you know, echoing a real life situation that students might be into. And I always keep in mind, you know, struggling learners or students that might find it difficult. So I like to do something like this in groups or pairs. And I would, you know, give them a vocabulary or relevant expressions that they might use as well. And again, I'm a strong believer that if you're going to bring in something external into the classroom, it has to be echo with something you're teaching in the unit itself. For example, in this case, I had a unit about clothes and so on, and about a profession. So they came across, you know, the shopkeeper, and they could interact with this image as well, and you could divide them into parts, and then you could set them on the task and ask about the size, the color, the price, or is it comfortable or not. And that's another example. And the nice thing as well is that you don't have to print out everything. It's all there. You have plenty of images that you could just insert and create a whole lesson about as well. And the next activity is called Look, Remember, and Write. I think it's pretty easy to guess what it's about from the title. So you show a set of words and ask pupils to write as many words as possible in a given amount of time. I would like to remind you all about using a stopwatch or online stopwatches to make it more fun for your learners. And it's very important that you show here words that students have already learned. That means you won't go in and show a word that they would struggle with learning. For example, island. If they haven't learned it, they won't know how it's read or what it means. It has to be something that they are very much familiar with. And in this case, for example, I could show them a set of verbs, or if I'm teaching a unit about another theme, it could be something else. And then I would make the words disappear, and I would say, okay, go, ready, set, go, drop down as many words as you could remember from the shared screen that I showed them. Okay, and because we keep in mind also different learning styles, and we as teachers need to vary our methods, the same activity could be done with an image as well, where you could share an image, and of course you would connect the image to something you're teaching in the classroom, and you would show it to them, and then again you would give them an amount of time to look at the image, and then you would make it disappear and ask them to write things they have actually seen in the image that you presented. And this is a nice activity to review also spelling, because we know as teachers how much errors our learners make with basic even words, and repetition is the key word to everything. And it really does help. It really does. I believe it really helps. So I try to go back and revisit words that learners have already learned. And yay, I think we're doing okay with time. I've gotten to the last activity, and this is something else. But I also use, it could be on an online, with an online lesson or in the classroom, where I ask my students to watch either, they could either write or speak of what is going on in the image. And I need to be careful with the question that I ask. So I could ask them, for example, if I'm reviewing grammar, the past simple tense, I could ask them, watch this scene and I want you to write five things or three or one thing that happened. And I would do this with my hand to make them understand that we're talking about the past. Or I could say, okay, while you're watching, I want you to write down what things are happening now. And I would stop and pause and then reflect and do whole classroom feedback with my learners as well. And when I play it, I put it on silent mode. Sorry. And I don't. Because the toolbar is on the bottom, I couldn't silence it, but I would put it on silent mode because the idea is to get them focused on actions and what is happening in the scene itself. And then I would say, okay, what just happened? What did you see? And they would give me sentences and I would write them on the board, or I would ask them to write and I would monitor and go through them and see what they have written as well. And something else is, for example, to get them to speak. Okay, I would again play it and not have them right at this point, but I would get them to practice fluency. And okay, 1 minute. I'm almost done. Okay, so I'll get them to practice their fluency at this point, and don't focus on accuracy with this. The idea is to get them to speak and speak and speak and speak, and they get to say what is going on in the screen in front of them in the short video, and they could do it in pairs or groups. They could help each other and give, you know, each other words, and keep on the idea is to get them to keep on talking. And once the teacher says next, they stop and the next group starts to talk and they have to continue with the narration. And the winner at the end is the group that didn't have a lot of pauses or didn't have a lot of silent, you know, time throughout the speaking activity, and they actually got to speak a lot and practice their fluency. And I promise this is the last one, please bear with me. And at this point I would practice with them, you know, what will happen next, and get them just motivated and think about what is going to happen next and get them out of the box of ideas. And for this I would suggest using ads or commercials. It's really, really, you have very short commercials there on YouTube that you could use. Maybe some of you are familiar with this. This is actually a commercial for our chocolate bar. So I would get them to watch.
Yes, me.
Can I just, 10 seconds and that's it. Thank you. Stop it here and say, okay, what can you see? There's, of course, they would give me answers and I would say, what is going to happen next? I'm just going to let you see for the sake of giving you all the chance to laugh, and I'll finish. Oops, sorry. Okay, let me scroll forward. He didn't know that he was exercising and resting, and he actually helps them to push the car off the cliff. And that's it. Thank you for being so patient with me, and all the best.
Thank you so much. That was so engaging and interesting and just a ton of wonderful ideas. This was really an amazing showcase, from games to a really eye-opening look at the Haredi sector, and of course Nesrin's fantastic ideas, which I want to go and implement right now. We don't have any time for questions. So I'll just say thank you to all the wonderful presenters.